Thank you. among us who bore our sin and sorrow, who even yet heals us and makes us whole. We are forgiven. We are healed. We are new persons in Christ, who sets us free from the bondage that we might serve him in joy and thanksgiving. God casts out all shadows and keeps us in his light forever. hallowed be thy name.
Father, my God, my God.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven.
Behold thy Son, behold thy Mother.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Thy thirst.
Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
My God, why hast thou forsaken me?
For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Into thy hands I commit my spirit. It is finished. Amen.
O holy God, journey with us.
words, he went off with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priest and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "Who are you looking for?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one to those who gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it, struck the high priest's slave, and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people.
The first words of Christ from the cross. There's no accident that those first words were, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." I think we all operate with whatever kind of information we have. And sometimes that information is not very much, but we still operate with it. Sometimes the information we have is all wrong. Sometimes it's partially wrong. Sometimes it's mostly right. And sometimes we do the right things for the wrong reasons. Sometimes we do the wrong things for the right reasons. Sometimes the wrong ones for the wrong reasons, the right ones for the right. But we don't always get it all right. We use whatever information we have. People usually think what they are doing is the right thing and what is needed at the time, or at least what they want to do. There are no villains in this story, not a single one. Judas wasn't a villain, he was a zealot. The thinking is that he really believed that by turning Jesus over to Pilate, that then he would show himself and rid the world of the Romans, lead the people in battle. And he was shocked when Jesus turned himself over to be crucified. And hung himself. The leaders of the church, the Sanhedrin, they weren't villains. They were defending the faith, waiting for the Messiah. Couldn't possibly be this person. They believed the Messiah was going to rid them of the Romans. And here was Jesus, who gave himself up. Pilate wasn't a villain. He was just working for Caesar. This is what he was supposed to do. Keep order. Make sure that justice was done. Just doing his job. You want him crucified? Crucify him. Centurions weren't villains. They were just obeying orders, as good soldiers do. They don't question why. Any of you who have been a soldier knows you do not question. You just do. Even the people who waved the palms at first and then shouted out, "Crucify him," they weren't villains either. They were disappointed too. What kind of Messiah is this? These are not evil people. They're you. They're me. They're people who think they're doing the right thing, who sometimes are and sometimes are not. We are ignorant of so much. Ignorant of so much. Including the love of our Lord. and Savior Jesus Christ. And we do not know the full consequences of our behavior. We do not understand our sins of omission. People can be dehumanized even to the point that we can use them. We can block them out of our memory. We can forget about them. We can shun them. We can even kill them. Thomas Paine, one of the founders of this country, said, "A long habit of thinking a thing wrong gives it a superficial appearance of being right." Unlike us, Jesus Christ knew exactly what he was doing. Jesus, and only Jesus, was a realist. As I always say, if you think you're a realist, think again. A realist in human terms is just someone who wants things their way. The only true realist was Christ himself. Jesus, who knows what he can yet do, even yet do, in and through us.
Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest, but Peter was standing outside at the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You're not also one of this man's disciples, aren't you?" She said. He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. And Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask?" And those who heard what I said to them, they know what I said. When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus. to the high priest. Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You're not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed.
From the cross these words, "Today you will be with me in paradise." We're not talking about Mother Teresa here, not Billy Graham, not a Girl Scout leader, not even your next door neighbor who yells at little kids in his yard. We're talking about a hardened criminal. A hardened criminal who maybe didn't do any more than two or three decent things in his entire life. We have no idea. "Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus does not say, "Well, you should have thought about that before. Now's a heck of a time." He turns to him and he says, "Today, you will be with me in paradise." So what turned this guy around? Dying? Frightened? Maybe hedging his bets just in case? Maybe he heard the first words of Jesus from the cross. Maybe that's what converted him. We don't really know. What turned him around, and why not the other criminal? What was it that allowed the one to see and prevented the other one from seeing? I'm not good at seeing star formations. I love looking at stars. I love looking up at the night sky. The only star formations I can figure out are the Little and the Big Dipper. And I know Orion's belt. But other than that, I'm lost. I'm lost in the stars. Is that because of lack of practice? Lack of interest? Because I was never instructed? Because I get freaked out by so many stars? There's an interesting movie that in this film, this character at one point says, "Maybe God is laughing that we never left the Garden of Eden. Maybe we're still in it. Maybe it's just all covered up with dirt and grime and soot. Maybe it's all around us." Often thought of that. We need a past, present, and future faith. We need our past forgiven so we can move forward. We need strength for the now. We need hope for the future. But it is very much like a car with its windows and mirrors. Rather small rear view mirror. Rather small mirror to see where you came from. What you need is this huge mirror to see where you're going, where you are. Even this criminal somehow understood, although he didn't understand. A little bit of faith, Jesus says, the size of a mustard seed. The other one couldn't see beyond his own suffering. Even at this point, "If you're the Messiah," he says, "do something." He didn't understand that Jesus did. That he has, that he does, and that he will.
Thank you.
Jesus from Cyprus to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual of defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." Now this was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or do others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation, the chief priests, have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So are you a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?" After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit.
"Son, behold your mother. Woman, behold your son." In the immediate setting, of course, it's John and Mary that Jesus is talking about. But it's really all this. If you're the parent of a young child now or have grown children, then you know what I mean. I say when you hear the cry of a baby, a young one, your mommy or your daddy, your head turns. Listen, see, it was your child. Behold your brothers, your sisters, your mothers, your fathers, your sons, your daughters, Jesus tells us. They're all yours. And here I thought I was an only child. For the longest time, that's what I thought. You know that old phrase that we fall back on? Can't help everyone. The fact of the matter is, we can. As a matter of fact, not only can we, Jesus commands it. Help everyone, he says. Be a brother, a sister, a father, a mother to everyone. To not exclude a single soul on the face of this earth. That's what Christ says. So my direction. It's his. Believe me, at times I wish they weren't his directions. Whatever you have done to the least of these, Jesus says, you have done it to me. The least of these. Love God. Love one another. Mark Twain had a friend who said he was going to Mount Sinai and shout out the Ten Commandments. Twain suggested that he stay home and keep them. The world does not need people who shout out the Ten Commandments. The world does not need people who shout out praises to Jesus. Jesus says he can make rocks do that. The world needs people who will praise him with what they do, with what they say, with how they act, who are willing to develop new relationships with one another and with him. Those of you from large families will identify with this when I say that I come from a family of eight, and the question that was say, yeah, they are. And we can look out at this world and we can say, Jesus, are all these yours? And he tells us, yes, they are. Behold your father. Behold your mother. Behold your sister. Behold your brother.
Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns put on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, Hail, King of the Jews, and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him. So Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to them, Here is the man. When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, Crucify him! Crucify him! Jesus said to them, Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him. The Jews answered him, We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God. Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, Where are you from? But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you? Jesus answered, You would have no power over me unless it had been given you from above. Therefore the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin. From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself himself against the emperor. When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus.
Words from the cross said with probably incredible agony, "Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And from this pulpit, I say to you, my God, why haven't you forsaken me? It's not as if I didn't really give you reason to do it. Our Lord and our Savior, abandoned on the cross, totally abandoned on the cross by God, so that we would never be totally abandoned. Even though it feels like that sometimes in this world, still not totally abandoned. We all have abandonment issues. All of us do. Some of us feel that good fortune has abandoned us. For some of us, it's our sin. For some of us, it's our memory. For some of us, it's our government. For some of us, it's our good looks. For some of us, it's our friends we feel have abandoned us. For some, it's our relatives. For some, it's an employer. We all feel at some point we are abandoned. For some, it's health. For some, it's peace. For some, it's hope. We all have abandonment issues. I have expressed the theory about pets, and I think I know why dogs especially are so excited to see you when you come home. The reason is how did they know you would ever come back? Always had before. But you might not. And they don't know for sure that you're coming back. They just hope maybe that you will. So they have abandonment issues, and all of a sudden they see you, you're back again. And they're so excited. Our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ,
called the Place of the Skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written, put on the cross, and read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am the King of the Jews.'" Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless and woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And this is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
The words from the cross, "I thirst." Pop never satisfies my thirst, neither does coffee, although I like them both. Only water. There are things in this life that we go after to satisfy our thirst that only makes us more thirsty. Fame, glory, power, never satisfying. Always want more, more, more. As the saying goes, power corrupts. Absolute power corrupts absolutely. People thirst for meaning, for purpose, for reasons for living. From the cross, I thirst. People often have an incredible thirst when they are dying, especially when there has been torture, such great pain. Spiritual hydration exists too. But we are spiritually dying and shriveling up. We cry out, "I thirst." I'm fascinated with stories of shipwrecks for some reason. One of the things is people adrift at sea. And there they are surrounded by water. And they can't drink it in because of the salt. Such an incredible irony. John 4, 14, Jesus speaking, says, "But those who drink of the water that I will give them will never be thirsty. The water that I will give them will become in them a spring of water, gushing up to eternal life." Not just one small gulp for the moment, but continuing on and on and on. Shohoya Yokowai was the last person, the last soldier fighting in World War II. He was still fighting, technically, 28 years after the war was over. He came out of the jungles of Guam. He had discovered an old pamphlet. The pamphlet said that the war was over. And he didn't even know it. He just walked out of the jungle. The battle to satisfy our thirst is over with Christ on the cross. But do we know it? Do we understand? When Jesus says he thirsts, doesn't mean just physically. More than that, even more than that, he thirsts for us. Jesus did not say that he was finished. He said, it was finished. A big difference between those two. It is accomplished. This earthly life passes so quickly. this life, it seems. At times we think we are finished way, way before we actually are. We're never truly ready to let go. We continue to try to hang on as much as what we can. And life at times itself seems to scream at us, "You're finished! What are you doing here? Get out of here, you're finished." The world sometimes seems to go to the highest bidder. Whoever makes the most effort gets us. And shouts are heard from everywhere, from everything. Our souls seem to be up for grabs. Suddenly, God screams out, "I'll give you my son." And then suddenly, it is finished.
Thank you.
petty with one another? Will they squander my love? Will it go unused? Will it go abused? Will it be abused and misunderstood? Now it's in their hands. Now it's in their hearts. The first words from the cross, words of compassion, compassion and grace, what Jesus' earthly life is all about. And now these last words that are a prayer. Not with a period, but with expectation and hope. All the words from the cross, in fact, are prayers, every single one of them. The Quakers have a wonderful saying that says, the service begins when the worship ends. So it sounded like death won, but I have a feeling God's up to something. So I invite you back Sunday. The cross was not the end for Jesus, I have a feeling. And it's only the beginning for us.
After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices and linen cloths, according to the burial custom of Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there.